Tonight on Axis TV, straight from New York City, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with Daniel Crow, Joe Pontillo, Jermaine Warren, Greg Stone, and this week's host, Paula Poundstone.
Welcome to Gotham Comedy Live, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for being here. I'm going to be totally honest with you. I never heard of Access TV. They called and asked if I would come, and I thought it was AXS. NBC isn't Nibica. I never heard of it. Is it cable? Do you know? Is it cable? Yeah. I'm looking right at you. Are you horrified? It's not a test. We're just interacting. You use your smartphone a lot, don't you? So this is kind of freaking you out, just talking directly to you. Is Access TV cable? You think it is? Yeah. No, I thought, okay, when I'm in a hotel room, I'll use the clicker and try to find like a station. I wouldn't know what number to find it on. You know what I mean? I have no idea what I'm seeing. It's like there's 100 stations, and several of them are ESPN. You come to that horrible like sea of ESPNs where you just want to get through it, you know? It's like a goddamn Lewis and Clark expedition to get through the ESPNs. There's a golf channel where they don't even play. They just talk about golf. And they take callers. I can find MSNBC. I watch that. That's cable, right? It is, isn't it? Yeah, I watch that sometimes. Because I can tell by the ambiance. Like, I don't have to see what... I can just tell by the feeling. Because the anchors on MSNBC often have not left that studio. There's a feeling of seclusion about MSNBC, you know? They have a tendency to interview one another. I was watching one time. I didn't know. Did you know Andrea Mitchell had a show on MSNBC? I didn't even know that. I flipped it on, and there she was, and she was just wrapping up. She said, "Thank you for joining me. I'm Andrea Mitchell, and coming up next is Rachel Maddow." And then they went to like split screen, and Andrea Mitchell said, "You know, welcome Rachel Maddow," and Rachel Maddow said, "Well, thank you, Andrea Mitchell." And Andrea Mitchell said, "Well, I'm hoping my viewers will stay and watch you, Rachel Maddow." And Rachel Maddow said, "Well, thank you, Andrea Mitchell. That's really, I hope so too. What a wonderful show you just did." And Andrea Mitchell said, "Well, thank you, Rachel Maddow. I believe you're going to do a wonderful show yourself." And Rachel Maddow said, "Well, that is so kind of you, Andrea Mitchell." And Andrea Mitchell said, "Well, it's my pleasure, Rachel Maddow. I enjoy watching you very, very much." And Rachel Maddow said, "Well, Andrea Mitchell, that is high praise coming from you because you are so good at this work." And Andrea Mitchell said, "Well, thank you so much, Rachel Maddow. I especially appreciate hearing that from you, and I really hope that my viewers will stay with you." And Rachel Maddow said, "Well, Andrea Mitchell, they must be very sharp viewers because they just spent some excellent time with you." And Andrea Mitchell said, "Well, I'm going to have to go now." And Rachel Maddow said, "Well, I am so sorry that you have to go." And Andrea Mitchell said, "Well, I'm sorry that I have to go too, but I have to go. And please stay and watch Rachel Maddow." And Rachel Maddow said, "Welcome to the Rachel Maddow Show." And now it's full screen Rachel Maddow. And she says, "Please welcome my first guest, Andrea Mitchell." So wow. Now, I thought the whole point of cable was that you pay, right, for the stage, you pay a bill that comes in the mail, you pay, and then you didn't, therefore, have to have commercials because they got their income through a subscription. Wasn't that the whole idea? But there's a lot of commercials on those cable shows, right? We moved away from the excellent business model that we first had welcomed. I said, and in the middle of the day, Viagra commercials. I saw one the other day that it said they were talking about Viagra, and the voiceover said, if you experience hearing and vision loss, stop taking the medication and call your doctor. Well, even a guy, how fucking stupid do you have to be to go blind and deaf and still be looking for the Viagra? Honey, where's the Viagra? What? And I think most of us, when we go blind and deaf, would have the good sense to call a doctor. I'm not sure who else you're gonna call, apparently your cable provider. And the other good thing about cable, and it's really why part of the reason that I'm happy to be here today on Access TV, there are comics tonight making their debut on Access TV, which... Well, I don't wanna be disrespectful, but I think it's the same as not making a debut at all. I don't know what it is, except for we can curse. That's really the main thing about cable now. They do have commercials like the other networks, but you can curse, and that's good, because people are very touchy about language. I remember when my daughter was in elementary school, I had to sign a rule saying that my child would not use offensive language. And I wrote to the teacher, I said, you know, what offends you may not offend me, and what offends me may not offend you. So why don't you give me the list of the words that you don't want her to say, and I will go over it with her. And I promise you, she will not say the offensive language. Do you know that we've actually had often cases go all the way to the Supreme Court about offensive language? And now we only have 8 justices. So they could possibly send back a decision that is, fuck if we know. What I just did a CD, it's called North by Northwest, and it's a 2 CD set, and it's the first one I've done where I had I don't know what it's called, not publisher, but whatever the audio version of publisher is, Highbridge, and so we had to discuss it a lot, as opposed to the ones I did by myself. And so apparently on the 2 CDs, I say fuck 9 times collectively. And so they said they wanted to put that, you know, what is it, explicit language, warning explicit language on the outside of it. I said, don't do that. I said, here's what you can do. You can write, I say fuck 9 times. Because what offends you may not offend me, and vice versa. And here is my point. I was just working in Maine, and the driver picking me up from the airport in Boston to take me up to Maine, she said, you know, we don't want to get stuck in that Maine traffic, because that's when the shit can hit the you-know-what. What offends you may not offend me. I am perfectly comfortable with the word fan. You're staring at me so weird. This is really the first time you've been in this close proximity with people, isn't it? I bet it's because you use a flat thing a lot. Isn't that it? How old are you?
30.
You're 30? Oh my God, you look 10. Wow, would you feel older when now that you've turned 30? Do you feel like you're part of the establishment now that you're 30? That was always our fear when we were teenagers. It's not a problem. Now, do you have an accent? Is that an accent I'm hearing?
I'm from Germany.
Oh, you're from Germany. Wow, and what are you doing here? Welcome, first of all. Sorry, that wasn't... Oh my God. And isn't that what the rest of the world thinks of us? There was my chance to be an ambassador. Okay, what brings you to us?
Holidays.
Well, we've had holidays, and I didn't go to Germany. So you're on, like, what do you mean holidays? Is that how you say vacation? Yeah, that's not what we say. I mean, you want to fit in, don't you? All right, well, then knock that holiday shit off. That's not what we say. I'm kidding. I don't normally talk like that, but this is cable. And so I can. Do you have clubs like this in Germany?
Kind of.
In what way aren't they? What would be the difference? Ma'am, do people talk to each other in Germany? Because I can tell this is just blowing you away. Oh, the language is different. Yeah. Meaning they use German? Yeah. Well then, hey, listen, stick around. We're gonna be right back with our first comic.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Daniel Crow is taking the stage when we return. And stick around later for more with Paula Poundstone when she returns to the stage. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live. More great stand-up coming your way starting right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, making his TV debut, Daniel Crow.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. This is great. Very happy to be here. Being a comedian's always been my dream. And as someone who's currently chasing their dream, I am sleeping on an air mattress. And for those of you who are curious, air mattresses are sold in the sporting goods section of Target. Because apparently Target considers unemployment a sport. High five me. It's great news. We did it. This is great. I was in therapy a lot when I was a kid. Surprise! Not at all. Kid therapy is a weird place. Because when you're in kid therapy, they try to make everything all kid-friendly. Like, one time I had an appointment for my depression while sitting in a beanbag chair. And the terrible thing about that is when you're in a beanbag chair, it feels like you're sinking and you can't get out. It feels like you're literally sitting in a metaphor for depression. It seems like a bad idea, but I'm not a doctor. I have a subscription to Highlights magazine, so pretty close. But if you didn't laugh at that, it's your only chance tonight to laugh at a Highlights magazine joke, so not my fault if you didn't laugh. My parents got divorced when I was really little. But that's not the joke. What is your problem? Did you break them up? No, they got divorced when I was little. But I was lucky because they were both there for me when I was growing up. But for a minute there, I was pretty sure my dad was not going to be there. Because when they got divorced, in an effort to cheer me up, my dad bought me a boomerang. And I don't know if any of you know what message a boomerang sends to a kid whose parents just got divorced is. But that message is, you're going to have to learn to play catch by yourself. I should do some crowd work. What's your name? Bridget. Hi, Bridget. Yeah. First time anyone's ever talked to you at a comedy show? Oh, that's weird. It's the first time I've ever talked to a girl. All right, we're going to end the crowd work there. That was weird. It's a lot harder to kidnap people than it used to be. I'm gonna roll back because I phrased that wrong. I'm assuming it's a lot harder to kidnap people than it used to be. Because it used to be you could kidnap someone and you could make a ransom note just out of words you cut out of the newspaper. Can't do that anymore. You do that now, cops are just gonna go to the newspaper company and be like, hey, has anyone bought a newspaper in the last 3 weeks? They're like, there was this one weird guy. And they're like, we got him. And it's the shortest episode of Law and Order ever made. Came up with an idea for a board game the other day. It's called Clue Prostitute Edition. And in it, a prostitute gets murdered. Then nobody attempts to solve the crime. Which is just how it works in the real world. Very true to life board game. And if any of you were curious, it was Colonel Mustard, and I don't know why they keep inviting him to the party. He's killed like 10 people. It's ridiculous. I was walking down the street the other day, and I saw this girl, and she was crying, and makeup was running all down her face, and I was like, what's wrong? And she was like, my boyfriend just dumped me. And I was like, maybe if you did your makeup a little bit better. That joke's funny because they're not people if they don't wear makeup. That's. And anyone who laughed at that part is going to get like a think piece written about them on Huffington Post tomorrow. And then they're going to lose their job. Ugh. You guys ever seen the movie Air Bud? It's about to get edgy up here, just a warning. I'm gonna do my Air Bud material. If you're easily offended, you might wanna leave. If you haven't seen the movie Air Bud, it is a movie about a dog that plays middle school basketball. So as you can imagine, it's the greatest movie ever made. I only have one problem with the movie Air Bud. And that is that we never get to meet the kid cut from the team in favor of Air Bud. Do you have any idea how much better that movie would be? Just about some kid who's like, he doesn't even go to this school. This isn't fair at all. I guess I'll just go out for the baseball team. What do you mean they're making a sequel? Seventh Inning Fetch, that is a terrible name for a movie. Even though it's the best name for a movie ever. Love doing comedy. Love doing it. One of my favorite things about comedy is you get to travel to other places all the time and tell your jokes in those cities. My favorite city I was traveling to do comedy in last summer, I was in San Francisco on the day the Supreme Court legalized gay marriage. So yeah, yeah. It was a great day to be in San Francisco. I was a little disappointed, though, because I thought there would be a riot, like when a sports team wins a championship and everyone goes and flips cars. I was pretty sure I was going to go outside in San Francisco and there would just be a bunch of gay people flipping houses. Like, they didn't know what else to do. They were so excited. So they just went and did that, and then the news would show up, and they'd be like, it's chaos. Everywhere you look, they're raising property values. Oh, this is really great. But I gotta go soon. So, one more joke. You wanna learn a fun fact about me? Oh, great. Fun fact about me is that I am asexual, meaning I have no sexual attractions of any sort, which, as you can imagine, made me very popular in high school. Like, one time, I went to a party, and everyone was playing Truth or Dare, and it was my turn to dare a girl, and I was like, I dare you to volunteer at a homeless shelter for the weekend. And everyone's just like, that's not how we play this game, Daniel. You got to dare him to do something sexual. I was like, all right, give me a minute. All right, I dare you to volunteer at a homeless shelter for the weekend and make out with a homeless guy. And I was never invited to a party again. Thank you so much.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Joe Pontillo is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV.
I live in Brooklyn currently. All right, calm down. Brooklyn's gotten very annoying recently. It's trying to become like a mini Manhattan, you know? They keep building up huge buildings. Skyscrapers are always jackhammering. It's very noisy, very disruptive, and they do it quickly, too. Like, I saw two guys in the middle of the street fighting each other. And I was like, somebody should call the cops. Before the cops showed up, a bulldozer came, bulldozed over those two guys. And they put up a 30-story apartment complex on top of them. Insane. I moved there like 5 years ago, and I grew up on Long Island. So the first thing that happens, yeah, when I moved to Brooklyn, somebody broke into my car. And of course, being from Long Island, my first phone call wasn't to the police. I called my parents. And of course, my mom picks up the phone. She goes, oh my God, did they take your easy pass? I said, yeah, never mind about the stereo or the GPS. Two guys could be running back and forth through the Midtown Tunnel right this minute, holding up my easy pass, racking up tolls, being like, yeah, another one. So worth it. I don't know. Deal with a lot of problems with my parents recently. They both joined Facebook. It's kind of destroying my life. You know, my dad goes on Facebook. Everything he types is in all capital letters. It always looks like he's yelling. Everyone's like, what's your dad yelling about? I go, he's just very excited to be on the internet. You know, and then he starts tagging himself in pictures that he's not in. And just like anything, like a lamp, a couch, a cat, I guess my dad tagging himself. I go, what are you doing? He goes, I like the photo. I go, so you click like, there's a like button. He's like, no, this is better. That's the equivalent of going to somebody's house and going, oh, this is a nice photo of you and your family. I'm gonna write my name on it. Is that cool? You know, then my mom will call me up every once in a while because she has a Facebook problem that's happening. She'll be like, oh my God, call me back, it's important. So I call her back and she goes, all right, I'm on the fan page for Entenmann's. I go, what? She goes, yeah, well, you know, I bought corn muffins at the supermarket, brought them home, opened the box, there was mold on a few of the muffins. So I took a picture of that, posted it onto Entenmann's Facebook wall, and all they did was like the comment. I go, so what do you want me to do? She goes, what's my next move? And I didn't know what else to say, so I said, call in airstrikes. Fuck it, let's wipe Entenmann's off the map. Teach them a lesson. I don't know. I went to the bank today. They don't want you to go to the bank anymore. I don't know if you know that. Like, I'm trying to deposit a check, and the teller goes, what are you doing here? I said, I'm trying to deposit this check in the bank so I could spend it at a later date. And the guy goes, no. You get the mobile banking app on your phone. You could take a picture of the check. It'll go right into your account. And I said, well, can I do that with cash? Right? Because in that case, I could just take a picture of any cash that's lying around and say, this is mine, put it in my account, it's cool, you know? Game changer. I don't know. Been trying to eat healthy recently, that's hard. You know, buy fruits and vegetables every week, I throw 90% of them out. My garbage looks amazing, though. Open it up, there's a bed of lettuce, some cherries on top. I'm like, I'm not eating any of this, but it looks great. Bananas drive me insane. You buy bananas, you buy six, you're feeling good, and then you're like, wait, you can't eat them until they're ready to eat. You know, first they're green. You gotta wait and wait and wait to the point where they're still kind of green, but you're like, fuck it, I'm gonna eat it anyway. Or you don't eat them at all, you just throw them out because you're so pissed off. I'm like, who waits for food that you're not cooking? What an absurd concept, you know? Then somebody told me, well, if you separate the bananas, they ripen faster. I go, yeah, I live in a one-bedroom apartment in Brooklyn. I don't have room to be separating bananas. Like, one of these tables is my counter space. I got a microwave, a toaster, and then seven bananas individually spaced out. Days of the week listed on them, you know, just in case. I want to know what's up. I don't know. I've been trying to eat less meat. Because I hate the way they make meat, you know. I was buying organic chicken, you know, organic cage-free chicken, and it's like, oh, they're cage-free until you kill them, and it's not that good. They still die a horrible death, right? So I think I'm gonna become one of those people that, like, I want to go to the next level of, like, healthy and, like, animal-friendly eating. Like, I just want to eat animals that died of natural causes. You know, like, oh, okay, this chicken died of natural causes, lived a full and healthy life, and here's a DVD of its life and accomplishments. So you could feel good, and then you're watching it as you're about to eat the chicken, you're like, wow, ooh, he got a GED, that's amazing. He won a Pulitzer, what the hell? Certain animals have always been against eating, like duck. I'm against eating duck, not because you're cute, I'm just outraged by how expensive it is to eat duck. Anytime I go to a nice restaurant, the most expensive thing on the menu, duck. I never understood that. I think the most expensive thing should be the hardest thing to kill. Yeah, you want to eat lion, $75. You know, that's fair. You want to eat duck, $40. Really? I could just go to the park, sneak up on one. That's it. Throw it back in my car, free of charge. Maybe leave a dollar on the grass, let the rest of the ducks know I'm not fucking around. Yeah, so I'm married now. That's pretty cool. Yeah. I think one of my favorite things about being married, men can use their wives as an excuse to get out of anything. It's an amazing power. You know, my single friends call me up, yo, bro, we're going to the bar. All I gotta say is, nah, you know, my wife. That's it. That wasn't even a complete sentence. Just referenced her as a person. And men immediately go, oh shit, sorry, bro. Hope I don't get you in trouble. Can't go to the bar anymore, can't go to the club. Used to go to the club all the time. I was the guy at the club, ladies, you know, you'd be on the dance floor having a good time. All of a sudden, I'd be the guy sneaking up behind you when you weren't paying attention, start doing this shit. Because that's the move we came up with as men, right, guys? What the hell? And then women would be turning around, trying to see my face. I'd be going, no, you don't. And here's why women are better than men. Men see that and they're like, yeah, Joe's getting some. Women see that and they go, oh my God, look at this maniac sneaking up behind Tina. Fan out, girls, we got a rescue mission. Code red, go, go, go. Because women know what's up when you're single. You know, you go out, you defend each other from every psychopath that approaches you, right, ladies? Yeah. Probably have walkie-talkies, all available units, converge on the middle of the dance floor, we've got a grinder. Some men are sitting there like, yeah, what's up? All of a sudden, three women are approaching from the left, we're like, holy shit, and then another one drops down from the ceiling like a ninja. See, women defend each other from every psychopath. Men, on the other hand, we do the complete opposite. What do, guys? We wait for the crazy chick to kind of approach us, and then we grab the weakest guy in the group and throw him towards her. And then we leave him there, because fuck him. All right. I'm Joe Pontillo, you guys. So good. Thank you.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Jermaine Warren is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Axis TV. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live. More great stand-up coming your way starting right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, making his TV debut, Jermaine Warren.
Hey.
I'm a big dude, as you can see. I'm trying to correct some of this bigness I got going on. I started a running program called Couch to 5K. And I couldn't get through the first day of it. Because apparently, I don't even have a couch level of fitness. I have more of a bed level. So I'm starting a new program called Bed to Couch K. It's a lot simpler. Here's what I do. I wake up in the morning, I walk to my couch. I take a 5-minute nap. I do that 10 times a day. Till I get my stamina up. Till I'm ready. One of my friends found out I'm doing all this fitness stuff. He called me up. He's like, hey man, you wanna go run a mile? I'm like, cool, I got some vacation days. How much gear do I need? We take off Thursday, Friday, we can make a whole weekend out of this. I think being out of shape sucks. I think it sucks more when you used to be in shape because I still have all the t-shirts with all the stupid slogans on them. So when I'm at the gym, I look like the least self-aware human on earth. Just walking around with a shirt that says, you can't flex bone. You can't flex fat either, I found out. Try to be an okay human being. Every now and then, I'll give a homeless person a dollar. And I always have a friend who's like, don't do that, because I did it once. And then I saw him getting to a Mercedes. Like, you know how much a Mercedes costs? If you get one by begging, you earned it. That is your Mercedes. That dude's life fell apart and he found out he had a skill. Because begging's a job. You ever been at the corner store and you legitimately needed like $1? The descent is swift. You're just going up to strangers like, swear to God, I'm not homeless, man. Swear to God, all I need is like a dollar to get home to my family. That doesn't exist. It's just a dollar, but I'm very picky about it. Like, if they're dressed too nice, I'm like, not yet. Let it marinate a little bit. I'm like Goldilocks. I like my homeless just right. It's a very weird statement because I'm a big black man comparing himself to Goldilocks. Second of all, that's a stupid story. Goldilocks and the Three Bears? Trying to tell me Three Bears are making their own individual batches of porridge? What kind of family structure is that? Mama Bear made one big batch of porridge. It's the same porridge in all those bowls. Goldilocks had OCD, and when she found the bowl that was just right, it was just right. I say the word porridge, and you accept it. I've never met anybody who knows what porridge is. I've never been invited to somebody's house like, oh man, you picked a good night. My mom makes the best spicy jalapeno porridge. I went on Wikipedia and I searched porridge and it just says sea porridge. Yesterday, I went to Coinstar. That's how my life's going. Yeah, you never go to Coinstar when things are going good. You're like, oh, I ran out of all the regular money. I think this thimble looks like a coin. I'm gonna find out when I get there. I think this thimble looks like a coin. I was like, I have to ask myself, why am I going in the first place? because I have all this change, but count it with these hands? Who do you think I am? I'm taking my bucket of life savings to the grocery store. Every time I go there, there's a line. Not the greatest place for small talk. Hey man, how's your day going? About as shitty as yours, I see. And I don't know if you've ever used the Coinstar machine before. Nothing on earth needs to be that loud just to count change. As soon as you hit the button, all you hear is you look up, the whole store's just staring at you. You're like, oh, I'm not broke. I'm donating this money. It's a tax write-off. I am so broke right now. A lot of people like to play the lotto when it's $500 million. Never when it's 10. Who are these snobs? Who's walking in their corner store like, $10 million? Such a paltry amount. Why, I don't know how that could change my life at all. Oh dear, look at the time. My shift work at McDonald's is about to begin. I think Benihana has the cockiest chefs in all of restaurantdom. Those guys walk around like their name is Benihana. Authentic Japanese food made by Raul. Every time I go there, I act like I've never seen somebody make food before. I'm like, oh my God. Is that a dude chopping carrots? A volcano made out of what? Everything is going good till the chef starts eyeing your girl. Makes her rice hearts, gives it to her. Gives her a shrimp. You're like, dude, I'm not paying for shrimp. He's like, don't worry about it. This one's on the Hana. I hate underdog stories too. I think they're all bullshit. People try to tell you stuff to make you feel good. You be like, oh man, don't worry about it. You know, Bill Gates, he dropped out of college. I'm like, nah, Bill Gates dropped out of Harvard. Not community college. All right. It's good to be alive now. We have the Google. True. I can't remember the last time I used my brain. What's 2 + 2? Whatever Google tells me. Just one question is, what does Google want? Like, I know what Microsoft wants. All my money. But Google's a little different. Google's like, hey, put your money away. I just want to watch. Google likes what it sees. Uber is an app where a stranger will pick you up in their car for money. And we trust it because it's an app. Nothing creepy about a guy that wants to be a cab driver for fun. I didn't think you chose to be a cab driver. I thought life pulled you to the side and was like, you just drive cabs now. Uber is a thing. It can only exist because of technology. Because this is Uber without the app. Hey! Hey, man, where you going? Hey, $5 to take anywhere, baby. $5 to take anywhere. It's cheaper than a cab, baby. 1995 Honda Civic, baby, it still runs. I got a full tank of gas. I know that trunk is big, oddly big. It can hold, what, 2, 3, maybe 4 bodies in there? I'm not gonna hurt you. My name's Jermaine Warren, thank you.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Greg Stone is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV.
Ladies and gentlemen, from his Rad Dude cast, please welcome Greg Stone.
All right. Let's do it. Fun fact about me, I am drunk.
Woo!
Let's ride this baby into the floor. You better laugh, lady, or I will kiss you on the lips. That is gonna happen. All right. Biggest day of my career, here I am. What, is Channel 20,000 gonna fire me? Who cares? Oh man, I'll tell you about my stepdad. He is a crazy person. I wore a pink shirt the first time in my life. My stepdad walks right up to me and just goes, "Pink shirt? Well, I guess you're gay now." Like, what are you talking about? A pink shirt is not what makes you gay. And when you find out what does, you are in for a surprise. Then he backpedals. He's like, "It's okay. I would always love you. I just don't know how God feels." I love this argument because I know exactly how God feels. God loves gay people. I can prove it. He keeps making them. Well, that's the end. I'm not trying to do that. I'm just saying that's the end of my argument. You know what I mean? Like, God loves gay people. Like, look, it's if God hated gay people, we wouldn't have them anymore. Do you understand that? Like, we wouldn't have gay bars. We would have gay museums. That's how you would have to learn about gay people. You'd have to go to New York. They'd take you on a tour. They'd be like, "This is Elton John. That's Liberace. There's your cousin Larry. You can get a little Tom Cruise in the gift shop." And that would be that. He loves them. It's just silly. It's just homophobia, and I don't understand homophobia. Because I have been in a relationship with a girl for 8 years. And if gay was a choice, I would choose. Absolutely. Are you kidding? Look, women, you're beautiful. You smell good. You're smart. But I'll be honest, I don't know what the fuck you're talking about. 90% of the time. 90. 90. Like when I come home drunk, my girlfriend's like, "Are you drunk? Get in the room." Or whatever she's saying. I'm not listening. But when I come home drunk, my roommate Anthony is like, "Are you drunk? Do you want to get high and watch Star Wars?" I am like, "Yes! Yes! Yes! You get me. I want to fuck that. That's the dream. He's little, he's hairy, we'll eat carbs, no one will cry about it. That is the best case scenario." But I can't, because I'm straight. Sucks. Bisexual, though, let's be honest, if you are bisexual, you win. You win. You can have sex with both. That's like going to a buffet and having no allergies. You just have whatever you want. You have the lobster, the dick, the vagina. Put it on your mouth. You love it all. God bless you. It's crazy, man. People put things on gay that aren't gay. They're like, "Duh, that, what are you drinking, a Malibu Bay Breeze? Gay. What are you having, a drink, listening to Barbara Streisand? Gay." No, delicious drink, platinum award-winning artist. That is what that is. People forget. The only thing that makes you gay is being attracted to the same sex. If you're not attracted to the same sex, you can't be gay. I don't care what you do. Like, I'm attracted to women. It sucks, but it's true. Literally, I can't be gay. I've tried. Listen, I mean, really, literally every guy in this room, you could line up at the door and I could just give you all complimentary hand jobs. Just like, "Have a good night, have a good night, have a good night. There's a 2-drink minimum. You did it? All right, have a good night." It's not gonna make me gay. That's like going to a Chinese restaurant, eating it, and then waking up Chinese. Like, that's not gonna happen. That's not how it works. Like, I was fighting with this guy, right? I was fighting with this guy on Facebook, because that's who I am. He was like, "If I hooked up with a chick and found out she used to be a guy, I would freak out. I ain't gay." I was like, "Yeah, that doesn't make you gay. That's a woman who at one time was a man. I'm a man who at one time was a boy. If you hooked up with me, you wouldn't be a pedophile." Like, you get that, right?
how it works.
Well, you guys are crazy.
I've gotten fat. That happened. You can't tell because I have a nice shirt and I look great, but I've gained so much weight. I didn't realize until I was at a party. I was at this party and this girl was handing out cookies. She was handing out fresh cookies and she was like, "Who wants a cookie?" And I was like, "Daddy wants a cookie." And then I grab a cookie and she looks at me and goes, "Are you sure? Are you sure you want one of these cookies?" And now I'm like, now I'm eating two cookies. So then I just eat two cookies, throw them in my mouth. She looks at her friend and goes, "Oh my God, I can't believe he just ate two cookies." And now I'm so angry because I didn't know I had to drown a woman. I didn't know that was what I had to do today. I didn't have that on my list. Now I gotta put that on my list. So I'm driving home and I'm getting furious. I am angry, I'm getting angrier and angrier. And I'm like, why was she so rude about these cookies? I love cookies. I love cookies and I love Wookiees and I love Star Wars and I love Star Wars. Is that a movie? I would make that movie. That's fun. What are you talking about? Holy shit, I am high. But I didn't smoke pot or anything. So I'm like, how am I high? Am I having a stroke? What is happening? So if you're following the story, this woman was not being rude about my weight. She just had medical grade pot cookies and literally was trying to warn me. She was like, "Are you sure you want these cookies?" I was like, "Fuck you, give me the cookies." And then I ate two. And she was like, "Oh my God, I can't believe you ate two cookies. You're gonna die. You are gonna die." No, but that is a problem. That is a problem. You can't give me pot cookies and then not tell me, because now I'm driving. I am driving, and what do you do in that scenario? When you are way too high and you're already behind the wheel? Well, I'm gonna tell you the first thing you do, you put the hazards on. You gotta hit that little button, let the world around you know I'm gonna be going 5 miles an hour, and I can taste the other cars. That is a red car. It is a strawberry car. It tastes awesome. That's not, I wish that was the end of the story. That is not the end of the story. I had to pull the car over. I have to pull the car over because I don't know how to handle it. I'm 35, I'm new to pot. I'm way too new, which is crazy. Because look, if you're 35 and you decide to start smoking, that is a problem. Like, I call my friends, I'm like, "You wanna get high?" And they're like, "I have kids." I'm like, "Do your kids want to get high? Are they cool?" So I gotta pull the car over. I'm freaking out. I'm getting higher and higher and higher. And my brain just says to my other brain, it's like, "Greg, you gotta go in that bodega. You gotta buy some milk. Buy some milk. Milk is gonna smooth this out. That's what's gonna happen. If you don't smoke pot, that's not a thing. It's not a real thing." But I'm not gonna argue with my brain. I'm like, "All right, let's do it." So I walk into the bodega. First off, I'm like, as long as no one knows I'm high, I'll be cool. Everybody knew I was high. Everybody. I walked in with the money already in my hand. Like, "Hello! Does anybody have milk? I have a milk coupon. Is that what this is called?" "No, it's called money, you idiot." But I'm like, So the guy's like, "Get the milk, it's over there." So I crab walk. I'm like, I'm like, "Is this how people walk?" And I'm like, "I don't know." Grab the milk, I hammer dance back. I put the milk on the table and I look at the guy and I have the money still in my hand and he was like, "You gotta pay for this." And I'm like, "I don't know how to pay for this." So I'm like, "Drake, just take the money from this hand, put it in this hand, extend this hand. That's all you gotta do." I was way too high to do that. I took the money from this hand, put it in this hand, extended this hand, but was way too stoned, so I just ripped $10. I just looked at a guy and went, "No!" and watched myself do it, like, "Please!" I just ripped this money in half, like some kind of Occupy Wall Street protest. Like, "Is this your God?" And then just ripped the money. That's it for me. I'm Greg Stone. Thank you guys so much.
the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Paula Poundstone is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV.
I'm in the show business. I know how this is done. The day after this airs, these four guys are going to be recognized everywhere they go. Who told that amusing little pot story will probably be arrested by a cop who gets and knows he gets Access TV. It's not a matter of getting it. Apparently, we all get it. It's a matter of knowing that you get Access TV. And ironically, being able to access it. Ladies and gentlemen, please, let's bring up